الحديث الثاني, the second hadith, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يقبل الله صلاة أحدكم إذا أحدث حتى يتوضأ. Abu Hurairah narrated that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يقبل الله, Allah does not accept صلاة أحدكم, the prayer of one of you, إذا أحدث, if he comes with major or minor impurity. إذا أحدث, if he does minor impurity. Minor impurity. لا يقبل الله, Allah does not accept صلاة أحدكم, the prayer of one of you, إذا أحدث, if he comes with minor impurity, حتى يتوضأ, until he does wudu. Until he does wudu. This hadith is collected by Imam Al-Bukhari and also Imam Al-Muslim. And that's the condition of AbdulQani Al Maqdisi. Imam Al-Bukhari narrated in two places in his Sahih. He narrated in Kitab al-Wudu, Babu la tuqbalu salat bighayri al-tuhur. And he also narrated in his Kitab al-Hiyal, Babu fi salah. Imam al-Muslim, on the other hand, he narrated in Kitab al-Tahara, Babu taharatu al-salah. And you need to know, the chapterings of Muslim was not done by Imam Muslim. It was done by Imam al-Nawawi and others. But he mentioned the books of his kitab. So Bukhari narrated in two places and Muslim narrated in one place. And the wording of this is Bukhari's. The wording is owned by Bukhari, the wording that we're taking. The narrator of the hadith, his name is Abu Hurairah. And his name is disputed upon 30 different views regarding his name. The strongest is AbdulRahman ibn Sakhr. Dosi, who is from the people of Dosi, Al-Azdi, and he was a Yemeni. He took Islam, Amu Khaybar, the year of Khaybar is when he took Islam. And he participated, the Prophet ﷺ, with that battle. He then remained with the Messenger ﷺ ever since he took Islam. And he is referred to as Hafidh al-Sahaba, Warawiyatul Islam. He's referred to as the Hafiz of Islam and the Sahabas. He is the one who narrated the most ahadith. He died, rahimahullah, when the year was 57. Ala asah al-aqwali, that's the strongest view. And he died in Baqir. He was buried in Baqir. So he remained with the Prophet ﷺ that year of Khaybar, which was the seventh year, the eighth year, the ninth year, and the tenth year the Prophet died. So he remained with the Prophet for how many years? 4 years he stayed with the Prophet. Only 4 years, and there is no narration greater than him in number. This hadith deals with the ruling of the salah without wudu. Without wudu. This hadith deals with the salah without wudu. Let's stand over the wordings of the hadith. لا يقبل الله, Allah does not accept. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept. Remember, it's in a, the way it's written is بصيغه النفي, it's a negation. But it is the highest level of prohibition. It prohibits a person from praying a salah without wudu. And it also tells them, so it's got prohibition and it's got negation. It's prohibiting you from it, and it's also negating the fact that your salah won't be accepted. So it's got two things. And that shows you the eloquence of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Salah linguistically means dua, and the technical meaning is ibadatun. It's a ibadah, which is that to aqwal, a ibadah that consists of speech and actions, makhsusa, that are specific, to adda fi awqatin makhsusa, that are established at specific times. It starts and it opens with takbir, and it finishes with at-taslim. That's what it means technically. The word ahdatha, what does it mean? Imam Bukhaaree, in one of his narrations, he mentions that a man from the people of Hadramaut, Yemen, came to Abu Hurairah and said to him, what is the hadith in this hadith? What does it mean? And he said to him, it means passing a wind or the sound. So he explained it, Abu Hurairah, bil akhas, the lowest part of breaking your wudu, passing wind. Passing wind is the lowest. Urine is greater, feces is greater, doing your call of nature. But it doesn't mean, Abu Hurairah is not saying that it's only passing wind or the sound. That doesn't mean that. But he was explaining it to him. He was explaining it to him. Because you can't pray if you've just done, you've just come out of the toilet, you've urinated, you've done a call of nature, they break the wudu. The sleeping also breaks the wudu. The hadith is two types. Hadith akbar, hadith asghar. Hadith is two types. There's a hadith which is akbar, which is three. Hadith akbar is three. It is janaba, it is also hayd, and it's also nifas. Janaba means what? When the person goes through sexual intercourse, what has now befallen on them is called janaba. You have to lift it up with major tahara by having a ghusl. That state that you're in is called hadath akbar. Also, when the woman is on her menstrual cycle, it's called hayd. She's also, what she is at that particular moment is called hadath akbar. And also the third, which is when the woman goes through nifas, meaning she gives birth and she's bleeding, her postnatal bleeding. That's also called what? Hadath akbar. Those three are hadath akbar. Hadath asghar is when the person breaks their wudu. When the person breaks their wudu by either going to the toilet and doing number two, or by doing number one, or also passing wind. Passing wind. He will not be pure if... So this hadith is referring to which one? Hadath akbar or asghar? Asghar. Why? Because it conditioned what? Hatta yatawadda, until he does wudu. Until he does a wudu. So if he has minor impurity, then he has to do wudu in order to remove it. Now, the wudu is the asal. But if he doesn't find the wudu, meaning the water, he's unable to find water, then of course, the tayammum stands in the position of the water. And other narrations and so have mentioned that. The fiqh that we extract from the hadith. The first point. Wujub al-tahara. It is mandatory to do tahara. And the tahara is a prerequisite. It's a condition which is prerequisite for the acceptance of the salah. And in this hadith, the word that is used is la yaqbalu. Pay attention, brothers. This is a fiqh which is very amiq. You have to look into. La yaqbalu Allah. Allah does not accept, right? Also, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, la yaqbalu Allahu salata. Allah does not accept the prayer of the person who goes to a fortune teller. 40 days of salah is not accepted. And this hadith is mentioned that the person who has minor impurity, the salah is accepted. And the slave that runs away from his master, which is called, and the abd, which is abiq, who ran away from his slave, he also, and the wife that disobeys her husband, all of them, the salah is not accepted. The salah is not accepted. The lack of acceptance here, does it mean that they don't have to come with the salah? So does that mean that that slave, he doesn't pray? Or does that mean that wife doesn't pray? Or does that mean that the person that went to the fortune teller doesn't pray the salah? Is that what we're going to say? Don't pray the salah because the salah is not accepted. Pay attention. The ulama have explained it. There's three words that are really close to each other, which is called qubul, siha, and ijza. There are three left words that are really close to one another. So the first one is qubul, acceptance. What does qubul mean? acceptance. Qubul encompasses siha and ijza. Are you with me?
Siha.
Yeah. The word siha and ijza. Siha means that the salah is sahih. And your salah is mujzi. Mujzi meaning you are rewarded for it. Does that make sense? Meaning the salah is sahih, is correct. So if a person, pay attention, he prays without wudu, pay attention. If a person prays the salah without wudu, we always say to him, pray again. Now pray with wudu.
Yes.
Yes. Because his salah is not sahih. The salah is not sahih. Mm-hmm. You see? So the sahih of the hadith, لا يقبل الله, is referring to siha, والقبول والإجزاء. Three of them is uplifted from you. You're not going to get accepted. We also have to bring that salah back. Whereas the slave, which is the abiq, we will say the ijza, the reward from Allah, is absent from you. Lakin if you pray it, it's sahih. The salah is sahih. Does it make sense? The salah is sahih. You prayed a sahih salah, which is sahih, as long as you don't, as long as you pray correctly. The second point. The salah, the second benefit, the second fiqh that we take from the hadith is the salah. The hadith here mentions that Allah does not accept the salah of any one of us as long as we come with wudu. Why did it mention wudu when we know that Allah does not accept the salah of an individual? Allah does not accept the salah of an individual if he comes with minor impurity unless he does wudu. The hadith here right now mentions wudu. You see? When we know that there's times when a person cannot find anything to do wudu with. He can't find water, nor can he find tayammum. And his salah is accepted. If he prays it, he has none of the two. We will say this is called, you have to remember, is called makhrajul ghalib. Kharaja makhraj al ghalib. It has been used for something that happens majority of the time. Majority of the time, you're not gonna. It's very rare that a person comes to a position where he has no water and he has no sand or dust that he can use. Very rare. So the hadith is talking about the majority of the times. You're gonna find those two, so your salah won't be accepted if you don't do wudu. Three. As-sihhatu la tastalzimul qubul. The third one is, the siha does not necessitate always qubul. And I mentioned that already. That the siha doesn't necessitate qubul. Meaning, the servant who ran away from his master, we will say, salatuka sahih. Your salah is sahih. But it doesn't necessitate that Allah accepted it. Just because your salah is sahih, and you've come with the conditions of the salah, doesn't necessitate that it has to be accepted. There's a necessity. It doesn't. This is something in the hands of Allah. Four. The salah, there are those which are accepted and those which are rejected. The salah that the people pray, there are minha maqbool, those which are accepted, wa minha mardood, and those which are rejected. Anything that goes according to the sharia and that which it's conditioned and it asks you to come with, then it will be accepted. And anything that opposes it, then it's rejected. مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدُّ. Anybody who introduces into our affairs that which is not from it will be rejected. Five. The salah is not accepted. The salah is not accepted without having major and minor purity. This hadith talked about the minor impurity, right? So the person had the major already. So the minor is missing. So he has to come with the minor purity. So the hadith shows that Allah doesn't accept if a person is missing major or minor impurity. The salah of a person who prays without wudu, what he's doing is haram and he's a sinner. If you praise him. And some of the scholars made a takfir of that person if he prays it, because it falls under mocking Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. 7. Honoring the salah and the status and the position of the salah, because nothing is accepted to do in it except out of purity. So it, the salah is great and it's noble. Allah does not accept from it except that which is complete purity. He doesn't accept that which is complete purity. 8. As-salatu tubtil. The salah will nullify by coming with hadith. Major or minor, it doesn't matter. Whether you come with it by accident or whether it's done by deliberately. If you pass a wind by accident, it wasn't, you didn't do it but deliberately, can you say, oh, was it my fault, I did it by accident? We're going to say, no, still your salah doesn't exist. Still have to purify yourself. 9. The wudu is not necessary for every salah. And where did that come from? How do you get that from the hadith? So it only, it means that if you don't, if hadith is mafhum al-mukhalafa, the opposite understanding is that if you hadith hasn't come to you, you're a state of purity. Until it diverts you from it. And I've not seen anyone who brought this out except in Muttafaqoon al-Aid, rahimahullah. He took from this hadith that the person can stay on one tahara for the whole day. It doesn't have to necessarily, he doesn't have to necessarily do wudu every single salah. Also, there are other narrations that show that it's sufficient for one tahara for the whole day. The fact that the messenger did it one time, he prayed 5 prayers, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bi wudu'in wahid, with one wudu, the day of Yawm al-Fath Makkah. And then Umar said to him, O Messenger of Allah, you have done something you never have done before. You've never done before. And then the Prophet said, Amdan fa'altu ya Umar. Umar, I did it deliberately. Meaning I was showing the legislation, the permissibility of it. Now that also shows, brothers, because the Prophet used to renew his wudu a lot, it is recommended and it's noble that you try to renew all the time. Because rarely, Umar is saying, rarely, O Messenger of Allah, he's never seen Umar, the Prophet, do it. First time. Huh? So what can you see from there? That he normally used to do here, we knew it all the time. 10. The salah, brothers, is a sila wa fiqa. The salah is a very, very, very strong bond between the servant and his Lord. And it's the path to success and prosperity. لِذَا لَا بُدَّ لِلْعَبْدِ أَن يَتَطَهَّرَ. And because of that, it is important that the person is on a state of purity. وَيَتَيَزَيَّنَ بَيْنَ يَدَيَ رَبِّهِ وَمَوْلَاهِ. And that he beautifies himself also when he stands in front of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. As Allah said in the Quran, يَا بَنِي آدَمَ, the children of Adam, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ, take your beauty with you, عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ, to every salah. The word masjid here means salah. Every time you come to the what? To salah, make sure you are in a state of purity. And you are beautiful.